It's glad to have you in the UK once again.
It's good to be here.
And I mean, it took us what, best part of 3 years maybe to get you here?
We've been working on it for a while. Intensely for a year.
Intensely for a year.
Intensely for a year.
Dr. Naeem Akbar. Mm-hmm. Father, elder, uncle, leader. Some people would describe you as a messiah. We know.
Oh, no.
We know that's not the case.
Yes, we don't play that.
And it's one of those symptoms of our experience that we need to address. Mm-hmm. I want to start by asking you about your own early experiences and your development that led you into the field of psychology. What actually set you on this path?
Well, I guess that my interest was much more, I began by wanting to be a healer. Mm. And my concept of the way that I thought I would be a healer was the aspiration to be a pediatrician. So when I went into the university, I started on a medical path, and I thought that that was going to, in fact, for as long as I could remember, I wanted to be a pediatrician. And shortly after my first encounter with chemistry, I said, this is not my path. And so I began then to look at healing in a broader sense, and kind of drifted into psychology as a way to talk about and to begin to prepare skills for healing.
So you weren't deterred by the psychology that was being taught at the time, which was based on racist principles? You weren't deterred by that?
Well, I thought I would get to what I needed. I was looking for answers, and I went there thinking that the answers were there. And so it took me many, many years of exploring all that they could teach me about their psychology to find out that they provided answers about them, but not about answers about us. And I think that what I did find, however, was that there are ways to explore the processes of understanding how people function. And the way that Europeans had explored their functioning gave me an indication of how we needed to begin to understand the exploration of our functioning. So that was what I learned from Western psychology, that there are ways of exploration that are universal. You begin to look into yourself to see how you function in your context, and then you begin to put that together, to analyze that. So by using their procedures for looking at themselves, I got an introduction to how to apply those skills to exploring and analyzing who we were.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So your initiation into the work that you now do, it began with an understanding of the work that the establishment had done around psychology.
Well, yes. Yeah. And it's the interesting thing is that I studied psychology at a time that there were other things happening outside.
Okay.
So I was going to school during the 60s. So in the background, there was Malcolm, there was the Nation of Islam, there were the Black Panthers, there were the poets, there were all these other things in terms of the social and cultural revolution that was taking place in the U.S. So even though I was in fact sitting in an educational environment, like it was very clear that there was something else going on outside. And it wasn't taking place in the learning institution, but it was the context.
Yes.
And the context, I meant the revolution in terms of the artistic world, the musical world, was saying that we need to know who we are. We need to redefine what we are all about. So that noise coming in from the background made me then feel create this imperative to take the psychology to apply to us understanding ourselves in much the same way.
Okay. Mm. So, and there were others thinking similarly to you at the time?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, it was in nearly every field of study, people were thinking how to think differently about ourselves. There were people in politics thinking about how to use the political system to move in another direction. There were people, as I said, in the arts who were doing that. So, so there were many other people. So the other psychologists and social workers and other people in the social sciences at that time were somehow saying that there are limitations to this. These skills that we are learning help us to deal with the problems that white people have with living effectively themselves. So what we need to do as social workers, as psychologists...
First, introduce the term white people.
I'm sorry?
Discussion.
Okay.
It's the first time it's come up.
Okay, yeah, well, I've been...
I was waiting to see how long it would come into the conversation.
Well, they... that was the context I was learning in. And so the question was, how then do we begin to translate and apply these skills to our reality? You know, and it was very clear that there was a different reality. The world was changing socially all around us. And because of that, we then had to begin to somehow apply the skills that we were learning, whatever kind of healing skills or teaching skills or instructional skills or economic skills, they had to be applied to how do we develop our communities? How do we develop our arts? How do we begin to tell our story? And so whether it was James Baldwin speaking in the background in terms of a literary effort, whether the actors and the kinds of plays they were doing, the last poets and what they were doing with music. I mean, all of this was taking place in the background of the, it was a cultural backdrop to what it was that was going on at the time.
Okay, mm-hmm. So that first phase is completed now.
And, yes.
And it sets the basis for the next phase.
Yes.
Now, with ourselves, and I'll speak for myself, with authority, your books and the material produced by Wade Nobles and A.C. Mm-hmm. Hilliard and a number of other individuals mm-hmm. Gave me the guidance and the clarity needed to go forwards.
Mm-hmm.
Franz Fanon and so on.
Right.
Also, where did you draw your guidance from?
It actually came from this social upheaval that was taking place. There was a social upheaval that we were a part of. Mm-hmm. And that's where the guidance came from. And we really had to go and seek out the guidance because there was none. But there were no black psychologists that we could look to. So what we had to begin with, and we spent the earlier part of our work just deconstructing the information that we received in the sense that this is the way that it's presented to us, whether it's Freud or whether it's Skinner or whether it's the study of history. And we found out that the study of history was limited to the study of European history. The study of the human psyche was limited to the way that they function in their reality. So we had to begin to deconstruct that before we could begin to reconstruct our way of understanding ourselves. And so we gradually begin to build this through this process. So for example, the founding of the Association of Black Psychologists in 1968 was the kind of like the dawning of the effort to try to construct for the very first time a black psychology. Prior to that time, there was only psychology, and to try to apply the tools by which European people had understood themselves to understanding ourselves. And we found that there were real limitations, because if you use that model, you always end up with the conclusion that you're somehow abnormal, because they are the norm. And we then had to make a construction based upon where we were the norm, where we were the center of the discussion. And that's how we began to build Black psychology. And we gradually found that we had to go kind of to the root. And the root of who we were was pre-captivity. And we had to go back before slavery to begin to understand that, which meant that we had to go back to traditional African culture.